Hello, I'm Chris Mack, and this is the third part of a three-part series of lectures that give you an introduction to mask making for semiconductor lithography, semiconductor manufacturing. In the first one, we talked about photomasks in general and gave an overview of the mask making process. In the second lecture, we focused on mask writing. In this lecture, I'd like to talk about some of the other important process steps in mask making, in particular inspection and repair, a little bit about metrology, and finally I'll end up with a very brief description of some of the challenges involved in making masks for extreme ultraviolet lithography. First, let's talk about mask inspection. You know, defects are a part of life in semiconductor manufacturing, and defects are bad. A defect can kill a die, and a die that doesn't work, we don't get to sell. But a defect on the wafer is quite different than a defect on the mask. If a piece of dirt lands on the wafer and kills one chip, well, you still have maybe 200 other chips on that wafer that you can still sell. But one defect on a mask will kill every die that mask is printing. Suppose you have a mask that has four chips on it, and then we print this repeatedly all over. Well, if I have one defect on that mask, that's going to cause, that prints and affects the die, that's going to cause a 25% yield hit. That's completely unacceptable. We have to have every single die on the mask defect-free. And when we mean defect-free, we mean no printing defects. No defects that could possibly affect the performance of the chip that we're making. Of course, we can have really, really small imperfections in our photomask. That's inevitable. But as long as these imperfections don't print to the point where they influence the behavior of the die, then we're okay. So we have to inspect the mask to ensure that there are no printing defects. We do this in several different ways. One of the options is the difference between die-to-die inspection and die-to-database inspection. You might recall from discussing before that most masks have multiple die on a mask. For example, this picture shows a mask with six die. Here's one of them. It's repeated six times, and there's just enough room in the exposure field to print six die at once, and of course we do that. Well, this actually makes inspection much easier. I look at a point on the die with my microscope, and I see what's there, and then I go to the corresponding point on the other die, and I compare them. If they're all the same, I assume that there are no defects. If, however, there's a big enough difference in the image that I see when looking at it, one die to the next, I assume that's because of a defect. I mean, the chances of the same defect falling in the same place on two different die is insignificantly small. So any difference in the inspection image of one die compared to another die, we can attribute to a defect. And if I see no difference, I can also make the negative assumption there are no defects in that region. Now, occasionally we have a mask with only one die. Well, if that's the case, we can't do die-to-die inspection. And we have to do die-to-database inspection. We have to compare the image that we see looking at the mask to the database, the actual data that was used to generate that mask. But of course, the image is not an exact reflection of the design data, so we have to modulate the design data to kind of simulate what we'd expect the image to look like, and that can be a little bit difficult. So die-to-database inspection is much harder to do well compared to die-to-die. But as I said, sometimes we have a mask with only one die and we have no choice. We also have a choice between using high resolution and stepper resolution inspection. What do I mean by that? Well, a high resolution inspection uses higher resolution to look at the mask than the lithography tool that's going to use that mask. Remember that we're using 4x magnification. The mask, all the features on the mask are four times bigger. So that gives us the opportunity to have a smaller lambda over NA. NA is the numerical aperture of the tool we use to look at the mask, and lambda is the wavelength. We can have a smaller lambda over NA for the inspection tool than the lithography tool. That is, we have higher resolution in our inspection. That means we can inspect using a wavelength different than the wavelength the lithography tool will use. We say non-actinic inspection. But especially for phase shifting masks, it's actually preferred to use actinic wavelength inspection. But nonetheless, we have some extra work to do. If we're going to use a high resolution inspection, then we have to interpret the inspection images to decide what prints and what doesn't print. That takes a bit of a work because you can, with a high resolution inspection tool, find defects that don't print. And then it would be kind of a waste of time to deal with them and repair them if you don't need to. So we have to do a lot of extra data processing for that kind of an inspection system. An alternative is to use an aerial image-based inspection system. That is, to make the wavelength and numerical aperture and illumination conditions of the inspection mimic that of the lithography tool. In that way, we are looking at the aerial image through our inspection system that's approximately the same as the aerial image the wafer will see. If we don't see a difference, if we're doing die-to-die inspection, for example, then we assume that the wafer won't see a difference and everything will print fine. It's easy to determine in this way if a defect matters, because we can simply look at how big of a change in the image we see because of whatever that defect is. Unfortunately, with the same wavelength in NA as the lithography tool, the result is a signal-to-noise ratio that is not as good as a high-resolution inspection system. You can imagine that a defect that's on the borderline of being able to print on the wafer is also a defect that's on the borderline of being able to be noticed in your aerial image inspection tool. So you see that these two approaches have their own advantages and disadvantages. I think the high resolution inspection is the most popular today. Once we find a defect, what are we going to do with it? Well, we could decide to just throw the mask away and start over, but the reality is we never make a defect-free mask. We always have defects somewhere. Well, at least most of the time. Maybe a handful, maybe 10 or a dozen. But these defects, it's more cost-effective to repair them if we can. Sometimes the defect is not repairable, but many times it is. What kind of defects can be repaired? Well, two basic types. A missing material defect and an extra material defect. Obviously, a missing material defect might be a hole in a line or a mouse bite, as we call it, out of the edge of a feature. In order to fix that, we have to deposit some material. We have to somehow reduce the transmission of this glass region that's supposed to be covered by an absorber. Alternately, if we have an extra material defect, a little piece of crud that landed somewhere or a chrome that didn't get etched away, the opposite of a mouse bite, I don't know what that is, a mouse poop or something. We need to be able to trim that off, to delete or remove the material. Things get a little bit more complicated when we have phase shifting masks, because we can also have phase defects, which are hard to repair. But the other thing is that even if it's just an absorber defect, we have to make the repair in such a way that we don't change the proper phase properties. EV masks have their own problems as well. We're going to talk about EV masks in a bit. So how do we do these repairs? Well, as you might imagine, there's two different ways depending on whether we have a missing material defect or an extra material defect. One of the ways is E-beam assisted etching and deposition. So in electron beam assisted etching, we bombard the material we want to be removed with electrons, and we put in a gas that will react or etch away that particular material. So in this case, I show a defect where we have a little bit of extra absorber material, molybdenum silicide, molybdenum silicon, excuse me, sticking out into our space region, our quartz region, and we need to remove it. So I irradiate this with electrons, put in a gas that etches away the MOSI, and you can see in the repaired version that it's essentially no longer visible. For deposition, we do the same thing, but in reverse, we put expose electrons and put in a gas that can deposit material. Ion beam etching, on the other hand, uses the ions themselves to do both of these tasks. So we might use gallium, and we'll simply etch away or ion mill this material by bombarding it with these heavy gallium ions and sputter etching it away. In terms of a region where we need to add material, we can use the gallium itself as the added material. Gallium embedded into quartz will cause what's called gallium staining, a region of the quartz that then becomes opaque. So with these gallium ions, we can do both etching and deposition style repairs. Another interesting technique that's become popular recently is AFM guided nanomachining. Here we take something like an AFM tip and bring it down, kind of measure the defect and where it is, and then we basically scrape it off. We take our tip and we just scrape until we remove the whole thing down to the level of the quartz. This is very precise because of the precision of AFMs, but it can only remove material. Can't use it to add extra material. As I mentioned before, once you've made a repair, you have to validate that the repair will not print. For example, here's a little bit of residual stuff at the bottom of this quartz. Is that going to be a problem? Well, we'll do some inspections, an added inspection with our mask inspection tool, but we might have an aerial image simulator that also looks at this region and simulates the optics of an imaging tool and decides whether that particular spot will in fact print or print fine. When we've inspected and repaired the defects, we're convinced that we now have a defect-free mask. We need to keep it defect-free, and we do that with a pellicle. Pellicle is one of those simple ideas that has just been a game changer for semiconductor manufacturing. Before we had pellicles, masks would simply degrade over time and we'd have to throw them away. A pellicle is basically a metal ring. Here we show it surrounding the mask here. It's glued on top of the mask, and then stretched across this frame is a pellicle. Pellicle is a thin, transparent membrane. It's very fragile. You can't touch it. I have a mask that my daughter poked her finger into one time and it just instantly popped. You have to be very careful with them, but if you don't touch them, they're quite stable. And they keep defects away from the patterns. So what happens? A defect, the particle, comes and lands. Well, it lands on the pellicle. There's still a particle there. There's still a particle on your mask. The key thing is, though, that particle is now out of focus. It's far enough away that it's blurry and it doesn't print. It's kind of like if you wear glasses. If you get dust or dirt on your glasses, oftentimes you can't even notice it because they're so close to your eye, they're out of focus. You can actually have a lot of dirt on your glasses and not even notice it. Same thing here. We can have a lot of particles on our pellicle and they still won't print, as long as they're smaller than a certain size. Now, the other thing we need to do with our mask is do metrology on the mask to make sure that we made it correctly. Some of the metrology we do on the mask is very similar to what we do on the wafer. We have to measure critical dimensions, make sure they're within spec. But for a mask, we have something a little bit different we have to do, and that's a measurement of registration. For wafers, we need to measure overlay. That is, we print one pattern, we print another pattern, and they have to be overlaid one with respect to the other and still have adequate results. For masks, though, we only have one pattern. And what we need to do is measure the registration, that is the positional accuracy of what we just put on that mask relative to an absolute grid. This is a much harder measurement to do, and it requires some fairly sophisticated materials that can generate an absolute grid to measure positional accuracy compared to. All right, I'm going to finish up this lecture with a very quick review of extreme ultraviolet lithography and the masks that we use for them. Now, extreme ultraviolet lithography is a bit different than the conventional lithography. It uses a wavelength of 13.5 nanometers, which is quite short, enabling very high resolution. However, we can't make any transmissive optical components at that wavelength. The only thing we can do is make mirrors. So EUV lithography involves all reflection optics and masks. The masks are made and the optics are made of Bragg reflectors, that is alternating layers of molybdenum and silicon. They're about 3 or 4 nanometers thick each. We have 50 of these layers stacked up or so. And if you get the thickness just right, we can get reflectivity on the order of 68%, right at the wavelength that we want, 13.5 nanometers. So that's the goal, is to get the highest reflectivity possible. Well, high reflectivity is still not that high. You look at all the different reflections involved, and every one of them, only 68% of the light goes through. You see that a typical EUV lithography system might have 11 reflections, in which case the total system transmittance is on the order of 1.4%. Well, one of those reflections is off the mask, and the mask is made in the same way as the mirrors. It is an alternating stack of molybdenum and silicon. Here's an example, both an SEM cross-section and a TEM cross-section. The absorber sits on top of a multi-layer mirror, and that sits on top of a low thermal expansion substrate. In many ways, the making of this mask is similar to the way we would make any other mask, except the mask blank. The mask blank is very, very different. But also, what we can repair and can't repair is different. We can repair absorber defects in a fairly similar way. We have to be very careful that we don't damage the multilayer mirror, though, when we're doing repairs. But a defect in the multilayer mirror is not repairable. So defects in the blanks can't be repaired, and that's a big problem. So, as we know, any defect on the mask that prints on the wafer will have a devastating yield impact, and we deal with that at 193 nanometers by finding all the defects that are on the mask and repairing them. Once we've determined that the mask is now defect-free with our inspection tools, we cover that mask with a pellicle to keep the new defects off, and then we have a mask that we can use in manufacturing. Well, we have a lot of problems with EUV masks. We don't have defect-free mask blanks. Every mask blank that we can make so far has some number, maybe as low as 10, but still quite a few defects. We don't really have adequate inspection technology that guarantees we found all printing defects. We can do pretty well, but not perfect. We don't have actinic inspection, to be specific. We don't really have adequate repair methods. In other words, some defects can't not be repaired. And we don't have a pellicle. All of these things are under development. The pellicle has made a lot of progress, but still not ready. All of these things have made a lot of progress recently, but not quite ready. And we don't have an understanding of mask lifetime. How long can we use a mask and bombard it with EUV energy, and that mask still stay stable? So for all of these reasons, there's still a lot of work to do before EUV masks are ready, but sometime maybe in the next 5 years, it's reasonable that we will solve these problems. Reasonably likely, I should say. But they're not solved yet, and there's still a lot of risk involved. All right, so what's the big ideas in mask making from this lecture? Well, mask making is a lithography process, just like other lithography processes, but this is not a mass production process. Every mask is basically one-off. We use direct write lithography using e-beams and for the high-end mask. The two expensive steps in mask making are mask writing and mask inspecting, and that's because of the expense of the tools themselves, the writing tools and the inspecting tools, and how long it takes to do these steps. As a result, mask set costs are typically rising a lot, node to node, something like 75%, that's a typical number. That's because of more masks per set, but also higher cost for each individual mask. These higher costs come from the higher resolution and the more features that you find on those masks. That results in increased write time and inspection times, and of course, time is money. EV masks still have many challenges, but we are making progress. Still, it's unclear whether the infrastructure for making defect-free masks and keeping them defect-free will be in place when it's needed for manufacturing. Well, that's my very brief three-part introduction to the art of mask making, the science of mask making. Thank you for listening.